Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Good evening, family.
Good evening.
All right, are we ready to praise God?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Well, come on, help me praise Him tonight. Welcome, social media. Come on, let's praise the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah.
Oh,
I am free. You about to say I'm free.
I am free.
Amen. Come on, say it like you mean. Say, I am free.
I am free.
Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for this great privilege of liberty, understanding, prosperity, sanctification, and righteousness. Therefore, Lord, we receive all that you have in store for us through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And therefore, God, with great honor, I acknowledge you in this great congregation that this is your ability, not mine, so this anointing shall be used to destroy yokes and remove burdens, but the glory shall be given to you untouched. And that is in Jesus' name. And Father God, thank you, Spirit, oh God, let us rest upon me, for you anoint me to preach this gospel to the poor, so we hear the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, cover the sight of the blind, to heal those who bruise their heart, and preach the supper of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and declare today the Lord's vengeance. Lord, I thank you, place in my mouth the words of prosperity for your people to experience radical and immediate increase. Excuse me. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You have your Bibles, look them up high. Repeat that. You say, this is my Bible. It says my word of God. It says the living word of God. It says it brings life to me.
It brings life to me.
Excuse me, I can do what it says I can do.
I can do what it says.
I can be who it says I can be.
I can do what it says.
And I can have what it says I can have.
I can have.
It says my life is better.
My life is better.
I've heard, spoken, and practiced
this word of God. This
word of God. That's the devil.
Devil.
You are too late.
You are too late.
We are believers.
Believers.
Amen, amen. Praise God. I want to welcome everyone here tonight. We thank God for this privileged opportunity to hear the word of God once again.
Amen.
And we're going to finish on from bills to billions. I know they have a great title there for you. And it's going to be our part two. And it's important that, you know, I want to do something a little different tonight. I want to make sure I'm not just standing up here, you know, preaching, you know, practical, biblical word, and the whom I'm preaching to may not be responding to it to build their faith up personally themselves. You know, that's your own personal responsibility. And I want to make sure, as a pastor, as a leader, you know, that you are doing that practical part, okay? That you don't see, you say, well, I was in church. Hey, that's great. But then you got to get that word that you receive from church on the inside of you. It didn't have to be a living word, a stirring word. It has to be a word that you're going to, it's going to be, I like to call it a watch word, a word that you watch, leads you, build you up, and so forth. Not to the point that, okay, now my life is really crazy. Let me go to the message from last Sunday. Now, you don't want to be in the lion's den when, you know, when you have time to prepare. You want to use that as an emergency kit. You want to use the word of God as your foundation, which you're going to build upon day by day. So please make sure that you are visiting and revisiting the word that is ministered to you by going to the recordings and talk to God about it and, you know, fellowship with that. So because we don't want you to, when I say we, I'm talking about the kingdom of God and myself, to miss out on behalf of God, to miss out on what that word holds for you who are entitled to receive from it. Amen.
Amen.
And one of the precious things, one of the greatest things to the human spirit, first of all, is revelation, then it's manifestations. Yeah. I'm going to tell you that manifestation, it takes you, free from the bondage, the control, and the manipulation of this present world. But this present world got a lot of stuff with it. I'm going to tell you, But today we're going to go over here to 1 Samuel in chapter 22. Thank you for the word. Receive your reward. Amen. In verse 1. And know this is our prophecy scripture here as well. And, you know, everything we do in the ministry, pay attention to it. You know, don't just look all up in somebody's face. You know, I didn't mean it that way. Just don't look at people only. Pay attention to what we hear. And it is a treasure. It is a found principle that you can live a profusious life of prosperity if you keep it for your eyes. And now, they did a great flyer thing over there, going from bills to billions. And that's how I'm going to tell you, everything we preach, we can reach. Amen. Everything we preach, we can reach. Matter of fact, all you do is move the P all the way, and you got reach. Okay? So it is attainable. It's attainable. And then we're doing, there's people outside of the ministry who's already been asking for the classes that we discuss on doing a conference, through the family, faith, and friends, family, friends, and financial conference. And that would really inspire me. But it's people on the outside that say, what we're going to have it, what we're going to do it. I want the people on the inside as well say, what we're going to have it, what we're going to do it. And one of the key things to that, what's going to make it happen, is that we don't need a new revelation. We don't need a fresh revelation. We just need focus. You ever seen the horse, that when they try to get a horse from one point to another destination, they put a what in front of his face? A what? A carrier, right? A carrier or an apple. And Lord showed me, he said, he never changed the carrier. And they never changed the apple. He said, it's the same carrier, same apple. He said, but they help the horse keep focus. And so we're not going to fresh, deeper, profound, more prolific, extreme, you know, revelation. We're just going to keep the focus. And we keep the focus, we'll go from one point to another. Amen. And that's what we're going to be doing. And so anytime people say, well, Pastor, sorry, I couldn't make it to this and that, don't apologize to me because I'm here. You can apologize to yourself. Oh, I couldn't make it. Oh, man, I got to do better than this because we're going to keep the focus. That's the primary thing is focus, because a lot of times people lose focus through distraction. I'll get to it later. Now you got to keep it in front of your eyes. When you go put it on your screensaver, on your desktop, you got to do it. Like the Bible said, put it before your eyes. You got to do it. If you put it before your eyes, you go from one place to another. Guarantee it. You keep it before you. Keep it in your ears. Keep it before your eyes. Keep it in your mouth. And you always find yourself being practical in that manner. Amen? Amen. Did that help you out some?
Yes.
All right. Well, we're going to get that. Amen. So 1 Samuel chapter 22, verse 1, he said, David therefore departed thence and escaped to the cave of Adullam, or cave of Adullam. And when his brethren and all his father's house heard it, they went down thither to him. Everyone that was in distress, everyone that was in debt, and everyone that was discontented, gathered themselves unto him, and he became a captain over them. And there were with him about 400 men. And David went thence to Mizpeh of Moab, and he said unto the king of Moab, let my father and my mother, I pray thee, come forth and be with you till I know what God will do with me. And he brought them before the king of Moab, and they dwelt with him all the while that David was in the hole. He was in this hole. He was in a holy place seeking what God would do with him on behalf of the people and himself. And that's what we do. We seek God on what he wants to do on behalf of the people. Now, when you look at this, this changed the whole dynamics about coming to church. It's more than, hey, man, I got to get my praise on. You know, I can't wait to see so-and-so, and I got some stuff I got to do at the church. And then say, hey, I'm going to see what God is saying to the man of God, the woman of God, pertaining to us. Yeah. Amen. See, this all pertaining to you. All this is for you. Yeah. Amen. You got to realize it is for you. Somebody says it's for me. And it's for you to get you from one place to another. And what we talk about now, to get you out of debt. So when we come to you with something, we share something, all of those are practical tools to get you to the next place. Amen. To get you to the next place. This is so important. Somebody said, well, I don't know. Suppose all the people that was in debt, distress, and discontent, they say, well, David, I don't know if I want to do it. I just don't feel like doing it. They don't just let the Lord receive it. But it's because you can't have a casual approach to the plan of God for the people of God. Amen. Amen. And so they gathered themselves into David to go forward and to get out of debt. We know in when we go into Chronicles, we understand that those same people, same men, who became captains over David's army and military, and they were given in a great abundance of multi-millions, up to billions in offering, because they went from one place to another. And that's how it is. And a lot of them could have left David. A lot of them could have, one time they thought about stoning him and so forth. But they stay connected. And you'll go through some difficult times, but just keep them. Let's stay connected to the message. It's that the message is with the man. Don't get the man mixed up with the message. Amen. You follow what I'm saying? Amen. See, don't take it out because the man made a mistake. I'm going to lead the man out. Who have the message? What Peter said like this, when everybody was leading Jesus said, hey, y'all going to lead two people? Where are we going to go? They upset with you, and I understand they don't understand what you talk about. He said, but where are we going to go? Who else hold the words of life? He said, you hold the words for the living. Yeah. It's practical. It's revelation and it's manifestation. Our life changes. And Jesus did some stuff like he spit on one man's face and eyes or received sight. But when the other people got upset, and Jesus said, listen, you know, you be a part of me, you got to eat of my flesh and drink my blood. They said, look, that you don't go too far. No, they didn't even ask him, what does that mean? They didn't even ask him. I felt like Purple Dollar. I don't know what's the reason. That's the first thing came to my mind. They didn't even ask him, what did that mean? They didn't even ask him. They would have asked him, would have told him, partake of my life that leads all up to crucifixion. That's all it means. That's not all it means, but that's what it means. And sometimes people depart from leadership, the whole things, because of a misunderstanding, because they didn't take the time to find out, to get clarity on what was said or what was done. I've seen that happen a lot. So one time we was about to promote a person, and we was at a service, and they looked at us during a time of exaltation, and I don't know what was going on my face or whatever. I don't know what happened. And they perceived nonverbal communication from my face that this was this and that, and it wasn't nothing like that. I don't think about promoting them. And then they want to leave because this is what they assumed, this is what they thought. And they missed out on big wigs. Hey man, they really missed out because they thought this nonverbal communication meant something. If you think this is something, if it's not on paper, it's not a confirmation, then you have the right to ask, hey, what happened here? What was really this? Don't let the devil deceive you, but that's what he wants to do. At your time of promotion, at your time of increase, he will bring the most simple, immature, unvalidated, make no sense to put it in a scale situation. Wow. And people miss out. And they be people who pray all the time and do all these different things, but still they miss it because they didn't do the practical thing. What exactly did this mean? Did I misinterpret this? What happened? The enemy will always do that, and he will do that to you when you're at your most sensitive time of your life. Like I said, that's when you're feeling just yourself. Okay? Not feeling nobody else, you're just feeling just yourself. All right. Now, I share that with you so you understand, because as we grow more in prosperity, more of these sensitivity attacks are going to come to you, and you have to be prepared for it. You know, I could say something, say, oh, I know you talk about me, but you need to ask me, was I talking about you? I'll be talking about you if you was the only person that was in here. Then I'm talking about you. You follow me? But there's other people in here, you can't say, oh, he's talking to me. I'm talking to you, but then I'm talking, and I'm just pointing you out only because I looked at you. I got to look at somebody. Amen. When we close my eyes, oh, I know you're talking about me. Look right up in my eyes. So everybody got to close their eyes when we talk now. People, they're just so immature. You know, and then when we say something about prosperity or increase of abundance, I don't be looking at you. I know you talk about me now. See, they can grab me and pick and choose what they want. Anywho, let's move on. Cheers. Let's move on here. Let's go here. Let's go to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 3. Deuteronomy chapter 3, we're going to focus here on verse 28. Chapter 3 and verse 28. Now, this is what God tells the people. Let's look at verse 27. And he told Joshua, get up to the top of the Pisgah. And lift up thy eyes westward and northward, southward and eastward, and behold, it were thine eyes. He said, look at this. For thou shalt not go over this Jordan. Now he's talking about Moses in here. He said, for thou shalt not go over this Jordan. He said, but charge Joshua and encourage him and strengthen him, for he shall go over before this people, and he shall cause them to inherit the land which you see today. He said, he's going to cause him to inherit it. But he says, charge him. Give him this mandate. He said, then strengthen him. He said, strengthen him, that means to refresh him. That means physically, emotionally, financially, you know, family and all that stuff. And this is where people get the message when they bring a pastor into, you know, they hire a pastor or something to that degree. First thing they do, they strengthen that pastor. First thing they do, Now, I'm not asking you, I'm not saying this for my benefit, it's more for your benefit. I'm just gonna share this with you. The first thing they do, they eliminate all his debt. They give him a car, cell phones, and everything that, whatever, that so he don't have to think and worry about, be concerned about nothing. He doesn't cut his grass, he doesn't wash his car, he doesn't pay his bills, all that stuff is paid. There's a gentleman, my brother was sharing it with me, and that church, he said, when we bring a new pastor, he said, they don't have no care. But once we hire them, we take care of all their bills and give them money up front, everything, so they can focus on feeding us. And you know what? And they don't get word like we get. No, they get a written sermon that they read to you. Now, it can be anointing the stuff in the sermon that you read and everything, but we know that God's hand is on this ministry. And so this is what God said. He said, if you don't strengthen him, if you don't encourage him, if you don't strengthen him, you're going to slow him down from getting you guys into what you inherit. Why? Because he got to spend time over here looking at this. He got to spend time looking at that and then take care of his personal stuff. Then take care of your stuff too. Then deal with all the other stuff. You follow what I'm saying? And see, that's why we have to come. See, I'm not going to allow people to abuse me in ministry. I always thought that I had to be committed to everybody who called me. This is my job. But that would kill you if you allow it to happen. And I thank God, every time I have a situation, you know, in my house, so I call Pastor Byrne, Brother Chris, they boom, they come on, when you want me to boom, they're right there to take care of, because they know that I don't have time to do that because of the quality of word that we receive. They're preserving my life. Amen. So I can lead them into an inheritance. You follow me? Now, I'm not saying this for me, but I'm saying this because, you know, Joshua, this is an example here. He said, in order for you to get out of this present state, to get to another state, to get out of debt, to get into millions and billions flow, he said, you need to encourage and strengthen the man who I called to lead you in there. Point blank. That's not an amplified, that's not a different translation, that's straight King James. And you can study to, the lexical aid, the Berean study, it's still going to say the same thing. Hebrew, Greek, Latin, Judean, you still going to find the same thing. But we got to focus on this. What do I need to do to make sure that this person leads me there? What's my part to do that? Amen. And this is so important. And we realize and we understand this because we got to make sure that the ministry is totally balanced. It's balanced. A lot of things that we do from the pulpit, we give this way, that ought to show that you understand that God has somebody that he can express his love to his people to. And so it's also supposed to work both ways.
Yeah.
I thank you for that yes now. I thought I was preaching to the wrong choir there for a minute there. And it's supposed to work both ways. So some places they go, the pulpit, people don't get none, but they receive everything from the pews. Yeah. Amen. And God is demonstrating that he placed somebody there that he can express his love to you, whether you give something to him or not, he's going to be taken care of. Don't you miss out on it.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. Don't you miss out on it.
Amen.
Praise God. Now, so we need to, you know, get ready for all these classes that we're going to have. It'll be once a month or every month or every 3 months. We're working on the strategies, you know, the itinerary for that, because we got to get you there. But I can't get you there if you're not here. If you're not connected, you're not doing your part. Amen. These are the things we have to do. And I appreciate those who do sow into a life, but as you do sow into a life, receive the instructions also that comes from our mouth. That God gives me to give to the people, that God gives me to give to the people. Receive that, but that's going to lead you to your harvest. That's going to lead you to your bumper crop there. Amen. And that's all the people in the ministry that do things for me. It's just that I just, you know, picked out Pastor Perm, Brother Chris, but that was just recent. You know, we don't been fighting the same tree for about a year. Amen. Last time it really went down, I just, you know, all this stuff added to the inner house. Ooh, y'all, let's move on here. And so you have to encourage him because he's going to be the reason to cause to lead you into the promised land and get you ready for it. But the promised land got giants in it. It has abundance in it, things you never handled before. You got to know how to handle prosperity, those big grapes and know how to deal with the milk and the honey that keep flowing, and got to know how to be, a good steward over the increase and how to give to other people. All these things, he's going to, and God, whoever God uses, will teach you to how to handle a promise. Now, you look at it, wow, look at all these grapes, look at all this, everything is super big. No, you're going to know how to go in there. Remember the time we took all the people to, $1 million houses? I forgot where we went. I said, we went on a field trip to school. I said, we're going to look at $1 million houses. I said, and when you get in there, I'm going to tell you right there, you'll have flowing staircases. It's going to be a baby grand piano between the living room and the guest, the family room, all that. When you walk in, don't say, wow, don't just act like you know this stuff. Yeah. You don't go, ooh, look at that, this stove is a flat surface. I've never seen anything like that. They were all crazy when they touched it. I said, no, just go in there like, This is exactly what Pastor said it was. Floating staircase, grand baby piano or something. Like, you go in there. I'll teach you how to go into the promised land. Amen. Because you go in there, they say, okay, how long y'all going to be? They're ready to get you out because they know that you are not ready for stuff like this. Amen. Anytime I see anything that's fascinating, I just look at it and say, that's nice. I don't just freak out over it, and taking selfies with it and everything, like I'm taking a picture with Irvin Harvey himself. I'm not being boisterous. I just had to do something. Now, look at this now. Now, so, they say every profit that you receive, you're going to use every profit that you receive to pay off your debts. You either use it to pay off your debts or you use it as a momentum tool to invest into another business or harvest or whatever God wants you to use to give to people and so forth and so forth, so you know how to separate and designate accounts. Okay? I was talking to a lady the other day in a public place, and the family are not believers, but everything I was talking about from the Bible, for someone from prosperity, she was just standing there and just listen, and say, give me your information. I said, I'm gonna give you information, but also I want to give you some of my teachings as well. Follow me? Because all that's coming from there. And they were just standing there, just listening. And I'm going to tell you, if you understand this, please listen to me. If you understand this, no matter where you go, you started talking from disinformation, from what we receive, people will put their emotions in pot and their ears will submit to what you're saying. And that's how we win the world. Yeah. We win the world like that. Because they said, she was talking about her spouse, and she said, I don't know what I am. She said, I don't know if I'm going to, she said, I just don't believe. I just like to be nice to people. Because they haven't come in contact with truth. See, they haven't come in contact. If you come in contact with the way, you'll come in contact with the truth. And Jesus is the way. But they haven't been teaching Jesus. They've been teaching men doctrine and so forth and so forth. You teach the way, but he is the way, and the way will take you to the truth, and the truth will bring you to the manifestation of the reality of the life. Matter of fact, he's all three of them wrapped up in one, but you got to come into the way first. So you don't try to bring people to the light. Bring them to the way. You follow me?
Yeah.
If you bring them to the way, he going to lead them to the truth, and then the truth, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. And he shows us practically, but see, people try to keep just taking scriptures and just so for preaching tools. He said, come on, get off that. He said, listen, lead somebody in. He said about the Pharisees, he said, listen, you're messing up men's life because you're shutting up the kingdom, the doors of the kingdom in their face with this old crazy doctrine and this stuff you're teaching. He said, because they missing out on the foundation of the covenant that God has given us. Amen. So this is vital, especially this day and time. When I look around, there's a lot of people who ain't in churches. They are not believing God. They just believe they should come to church. Or come to a local assembly. And it's sad in the hearts that people don't trust God, who holds all things together by the power and authority of his word, to trust him. Because the world has captured their attention. The world has captured their attention with bills, concerns, and provisions to the point they pit bull lock down on issues instead of what God can do for them. Amen. And We can't do that as one man from the pulpit. It's going to take manifestations of lives to do that. Amen. Because that's what we in this. And we're not just only to receive for ourselves, but also to help other people get free. Amen. To get them out of debt, discontent and distress and all that. Because distress is that's heavy bitterness. And people can walk around smiling and wear good clothes, but they are distressed and they're discontent and they are in debt. And it doesn't feel good when they give attention to it. Amen. But you should let them know that Jesus wants to do more than meet you in heaven. He wants you to be heaven while you're here on earth. And watch it. And he can do it. Well, how can he do it? Let him get a good picture of yourself. This is what he did for me. I'm going to tell you right now, it is good right now to make sure you do record and document and have pictures of proof of where you used to be. Because where you're going right now, people never believe that's where you came from. Oh, you ain't get excited. Yeah. Maybe I talk to you too much. You don't know what to say, amen. It's like, hallelujah. Ooh, that's good, man. What? No, I need to suck on some helium and say it in a different way. So, hallelujah. Come on, guys. I'm telling you something, and you got to change your posture. Because you're too stiff. You're too like, okay, no. I'm sharing something to you that can happen.
Yes, amen.
And it can't happen if you don't expect and get excited about it.
Amen.
Don't get too used to my voice that you miss the voice behind this voice. You miss the revelation. You miss the impact. You miss the impartation. You miss that. You say, well, I just love to praise God and then go home and mellow on out. And then God, when you go to God, God said, why you didn't do like I was telling you to do? And you just sit there like that.
Come on.
Because you held responsible for what you hear just as much as I'm held responsible for preaching it.
Amen.
I get excited when I receive it. And you see them, when are you going to fix that light? Why that fan on this morning? I see why the devil got victory over your life. That's how you have it, because you got to be focused on what God is saying from this pulpit.
Amen.
Amen. You got to be focused on it. Amen. Now, I don't want you to shout and own everything I said, but what, see, you got to show me that you discern when that anointing or that rhema is coming out. Because I know when rhema hits, but I don't see it when it hits you. I'm like, oh, God, I didn't get that. Because rhema got to be received. You follow? Do you know what rhema is? Rhema is when God speaks behind what is written.
Yeah.
Amen. They give you detailed, practical strategies, so forth. You just can't sit there like that.
Amen.
Matter of fact, maybe you need to stop looking at me. Just look down and just keep let your ears be your eyes too, so you get double the capacity for receiving. Because you got to receive this. Because I'm being passionate about this because I don't want you to miss it. And too many people are missing it because I see them when they miss it. I don't want you to miss it. But when you miss it, you come begging for prayer. I said, well, there was 10 virgins. Five was foolish. And five was wise. But you don't hear me today. You don't hear me. But I'm going to tell you, he's good. And he's good. But five, I got to hear five was foolish. Yeah, they were dumb, stupid, and poor. And five were wise. And all 10 of them. All 10 of them could do it. But the other five, they delayed. They didn't take it seriously. They said, I can do it later. Then understand, time is a gift to them. It's a gift. So every time you sit down, you talk to your friend, and you need to be working on a business plan, you're wasting your gift. Every time you sit in front of that old dumb TV that's making you dumber who watching, you wasting your gift. Every time you don't pick up that book or listen to that YouTube, you can't ask God for something that he gave you time to make happen.
Yeah, that's right.
And too many people waste time. And then you want to blame and look at somebody else because their skirt too short. God ain't called you to be no judge.
Right.
You're the first African-American Christian judge in the Pentecostal church. They ain't called you to be no judge. Amen. He wants you to manifest things.
Amen.
And I don't want you to miss it. I believe the reason why I'm saying this so passionately because the time has arrived for the shift.
Amen.
You got it that time, didn't you? The time has arrived for the shift. See, if you stay in tune, he said, oh, that's one right there. I got that one. So what you do, boom, it has been received into your spirit. Watch it now. And it's going to talk with you when you walk out of here. It's going to be a friend with you. And grace will minister to you and cause you to appear by what you heard. Grace will do the work. Not your money. Grace will do the work. It's not your own ability. It's not your education. Grace will do the work. You can get rich watching about receiving the word of God greater than you can by working, being a CEO. You just got to know how to receive it. Grace out of it. Not just I heard a word pronounced or explained. Grace. It has grace in it. It has an ability in it that will build you up and deliver to you your inheritance. But you got to allow it to edify. You got to allow it to enrich you and to build you up. And so you got to allow it, the quality of it, to live on inside of you. So you're too busy in church. You're too busy when you get home. You're too busy. You're going to be busy and broke. When I say broke, I'm talking about broken health, broken relationship, broken communication, broken social life. All you can be broken, all those areas. And God don't want you to be broke. But he that was rich became poor, so through his poverty, you might become rich. In every area. Amen. Thank you. Look at this now. Let's look at Joshua 1. Pastor Vern said, hey, Pastor, you been to the gym? I said, Pastor Vern, I ain't been to the gym in 8 years. I mean, 8 years. 8 days, because all the stuff that happened last week, I'm trying to catch up on this and that and so on and forth. But then last night, I said, I'm going to the gym. And then my car was messed up again. I was halfway to the gym. I went home. I said, no problem. I got no car. I went to that gym. Man, I tell you, that was like the best thing I could do this week. I said, Lord, I'm so thankful I'm here. I get out of this busyness. I know that's my power spot right there. Uh-huh. When I sit there and I can just think. Mm-hmm. Amen. I can just get there and I can just think. This is my place. Like, when I come here, what was going with me and half harassed all day, it can't enter in here. That's my spot. And I had to, it's like Superman, you got to find that booth. Amen. I had to find that place where I got to lay out. Wow, so God, I just feel the refreshing of the Holy Spirit. I just feel this and feel that. And so I said, God, so man, I slept real good last night. I slept very well. I'm sleeping good again tonight, but I had to do what's necessary to get to a place where I know that's why you're God. It's not the only place why you're God, but I know I had to break away. Because I knew what the enemy was trying to do. He's trying to tie me down and make this busyness, because I had to deal with stuff because of the issue that happened with the storm. To tie me down, so make this practical and habitual in my life. I said, this ain't going to happen, you're not going to run me. I'm going to tell you right now, I don't care what you do or how important you are. You have to have time to find your place called there. And recollect yourself. Amen. Follow me? You got, don't try to keep catching up with bills, because you don't catch up with bills that way. You catch up with bills the way that God is saying to do here. Don't keep trying to work. That's not going to work that way. You got to find that place. I hear God for wisdom, but the Bible says the wisdom is profitable to direct. Well, if you're so busy, you keep using your own wisdom, thinking it is wise. And he said, you know, it's the, he said, the word of a man leads to destruction. What is that? He said, I'll get to that. But he said, his own ways, what he's talking about? I'm getting that a little bit. That's just the way it seems right. There's a ways to see. Now you're going to cut in on me. I appreciate you. That's a way to seem right unto a man. When he's dealing with finances or how they did, he said it seems right to him. He said, but the end of it is destruction. You got to go his way, not yours. But this seems, anything that seems, stay away from it. You probably stay away from who it seems. Now, anything, stay away from that, because it's not going to be productive in this end. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, now, so what did I say to go? Joshua 1, verse 8. Let's look at Joshua 1 and verse 8. Can somebody read that out loud for me till we get there? Okay, guys. It says, this book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate the day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according that is written therein. He said, when you focus on the word of God, when you keep hearing the message and you keep seeing it, reading it, or hearing it, or speaking it, he says, then you observe what to do. Follow me? Follow what I'm saying? You will observe what to do with those bills. You will observe what to do with your finances. You will observe what to do with the insurance policy that you have, or the life insurance policy you have, or the doctor that you have. Anywhere where you spend the money at. Anything that will affect you prospering, you will observe what to do. He says that. All this therein, he said, then thou shalt make that way prosperous, and then you're going to have good success. But see, a lot of people get prosperity or prosperous and success mixed up. You got to be prosperous before you have good success. Prosperity is not a thing. Prosperity is a way that you take to get to success. Amen. Amen. It's the way that you take. You know, watch this. God is not going to allow you to have multi-million dollars if you can't handle a $50 bank account. I'm going to get my million, but you got $50 in the bank. You got overdraft fees. You don't even understand the bank. And then some people don't have bank accounts. Where are you going to put your money at? In your back pocket or your bosom. You can walk around with $1 million up in your chest. I'm just breasted. That's all it is. I'm just big breasted. Oh, you get big breasted. You don't get all that money up there. Leave that one alone. I don't see some look like they had a million though. Let me go ahead. Watch it. So you have to think, you got to understand banking, who you owe, how much you owe, and when you're supposed to pay them. I'm just gonna wait, everybody will be a hole until I get my money. No, that ain't gonna work on your waiting process yet. So if you're not qualified for the success, you're entitled. Follow me, but you can't get the success yet. Because you gotta handle those things that way. You know when see you got an inner bill alert on the inside of you. Hit like, okay, something I'm after my money. You already know that this is one of them. And you need to go find out who I need to pay right now. Lay it all down. Put it on your calendar, put it on your phone. And then beat it. So Lord, give me wisdom to outdo these interest rates here. Show me how to be smarter than this. And he'll show you. He's eager. He's flooded with such wisdom and so forth. But people get afraid. They just want to pray and sit down and I just feel a presence. Look, see, now you know. See, that's what people do when they smoke marijuana. Or they smoke used drugs or something. They sit there and they go for a feeling. Give me another hit of that. That feels good. You follow what I'm saying? See, you got to go beyond the feeling. That was an empowerment to take you, to help you be prosperous so you can have good success. It's not for you to say, I just had a good time. Me and God today. God said, yeah, we had a good moment. But what you do after that, that ain't power. You got all that gold, all that power inside of you, and you don't go no, I'm just saying, no further from home to church to work. Come on. He said, you got to do something with the power I give you. You can innovate, you can create, you can solve a problem, you can, all these things you can do. You can get rid of debt, all these things. He said, but you got to take the power that I gave you and do something with it. That's so good. And don't say, I don't know what to do. Because the one that you know knows what to do. And he said, if you're willing to do it, then you can do all things through him who know how to do it, strip you to do it through Christ Jesus. You ain't got to know it, you just need to know who has it. And he has it. You say, I want to do that, and by your will, then he that has the power to do, he will strip you. That's why Paul said in Philippians, I can do all things through Christ. He said, through knowledge, through the church, or through his money. He said, I can do all things through Christ, will strip me. But if you're not willing to do what you can't do in your own ability, you're not obligated to strip you to do it. He strengthened you with might. He strengthened you with might. Power and ability. But you got to be willing to flow. You got to be willing to flow with him. Instead of getting a shout in church, that's all you have. You got to go beyond that. So much that God has in store for us. Bigger than a check. Bigger than a house. Much, much bigger. And there's people already God got waiting. He's already preordained, waiting for you to reach one level so he can introduce you to your next best friend. To your next best friend. Because you prosper in this beautiful relationship. I learned from Bishop Fuller. But you can't you can't, the door won't open for this person to come in with that information until you step into that level or reach that door. Then that door is for hope. Amen. All right. He said, then you should have the success. So we see all of this is practical. These are things we have to do. If you cannot blame God for on something that you fail to receive, you can't do that. It's not even fair. You know, that's like me giving you a wagon with all meat in it and a handle on it, and you want me to pull it home for you. You can't do that. You take the wagon home yourself with all the meat. Amen. He provides. You got to receive it. Mm-hmm. You got to take it. Amen.
Amen.
And sometimes, you know, people just want, they don't want to do nothing different than what they've been doing. You got to do more than that. I'm charging you today to get up and live life and enjoy it and bring, you know, quality to the life of someone else through the life that you live and want the life that you know. Amen.
Amen.
I had to take my car back to the shop. The guy said, good Lord, what's going on? I said, okay, look at this now. And they want to charge these big dollars on everything. I said, God always provide. They said, but you know what we're going to do? The last time you pay us, we're going to take the same amount that you pay. We're going to credit that to this one. He said, we're just going to do it out of good nature. I said, thank you. You follow what I'm saying?
Amen.
I could have screamed off this and that, God, hey, la, la, la. I said, no, God, this is your car. You gave it to me. You have to take care of this. Point blank, I'm going to the gym. You follow what I'm saying? And so they said, listen, it's this much, but what you, the service we did for you last time, we're going to apply. This is not, you know, Billy May who works in the shade. I ain't got a shade account. I'm talking B&W themselves. You know what I'm saying? They said, we're going to credit the last one that you paid, and we're going to put it on this, and it took it in half. Amen. See, there you go again with yourself. But when you get your testimony, you run all around the church, fall on your head and everything. I'm telling you something else God is doing by me casting care on him.
Yes. Amen.
Because one thing, you know what I'm saying, I am a tither and I'm a giver. Devil, you ain't taking this. And God showed me how to do the rest of the month to the point. Hey, it wasn't even touching nothing.
Right.
Amen. Because he gave me wisdom. He gave me skill as long as I lean on him and not my own understanding.
Amen.
Y'all like that leaning, doesn't it? You gotta lean on him. Let's go to Proverbs. Let's look at it. See, you like leaning. Leaning. No, I ain't talking about that. But all they say is leaning. Leaning on the everlasting, and then my turn to say leaning, and all we talk about. Don't pay no attention to Vincent, man. Y'all remember that though?
Yes.
Are you leaning? Okay. All right. Proverbs 3. My son, forget not my law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. For length of days and strong life, long life, and peace shall they add to thee. He said, don't let mercy and truth forsake you. Don't let it get away from you. He said, bind about that neck. Uh-huh. Write upon the tables of your heart. You do that by making confessions.
Uh-huh.
It is said, so shall thou find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. He said, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. He said, and lean not into your own understanding. And then after this, he said, after he said, lean not to your understanding, he said, acknowledge him in all thy ways, he direct your path. He said, because when you don't know where to go, don't depend on yourself to get there. He don't need to understand. He said, that's what you do when you don't know where to go. You just acknowledge him.
Yeah.
If you lean to your own understanding, you'll get deeper and be lost. I'm going to figure it out. Why figure it out when somebody already knows it? We used to have all these issues all the time. I look at a device, I said, there's an 800 number on the back of that. It's 1-800-HELP. We don't know what we're doing, but you know. That's why you got the 800 number there. And God is your 800 number. When you don't know what you're doing, don't take all the parts of life to pieces and try to fix yourself. Call him in a time of need.
All right. That's right. Amen.
And he will give you the help that you need when you need it. Are you understand what I'm saying? Because he has all the information. He knows. He has all the wisdom, all the power, and all the resources. He knows. Don't sit there and say, I'm going to figure this out. That's the craziest thing to do, to try to figure it out.
Yeah.
But he already knows. Lord, what is this? That's what Daniel did. He He didn't say, I'm going to figure this dream out. He's able to add his head. And then he said, I'm Lord of God, who keeps, know all the secrets, knows your dreams, your down sitting, your uprising, your thoughts in 2,000 years from now. He knows all that. So let me go ask him.
Yeah.
No, you got to fast before you go to the Lord. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No man come to the Father except through me. He didn't say you had to fast come to God. See, he keep trying to put credit and some type of, the reason why he asked because I fast. No, the reason why he asked because he said he would.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, he said before the words leave your mouth, I already responded to it.
Yeah.
And what he told him, he said, before you even ask me, I already know what you're going to ask. He said, I already given it to you before you ask. I just tried to teach you how to have a relationship.
Right.
You ask everybody else for all this, but you don't ask me for nothing. He said, I want to teach you how to ask. And not just only ask for what you need. Watch this thing I learned all day. God said, you ask me what I want, you don't have to ask me what you need. If you do what I want, all your needs be fulfilled.
Right.
So I said, God, what you want me to do? How you want me to do it? And boom, needs come right there. Because see, every time you roll with him, he show you a shorter path. Lord, what would you have me to do today? That all my needs, boom, 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 manifest right there. Because God would have never allowed you to do something for him that he didn't take care of it already for you.
Amen.
All right. Okay, he said all that ways to acknowledge him, and he shall direct that path. But he said, don't lean to your understanding. Don't try to figure it out. And man used to be so good. I used to always like that. Christmas time, you know, hey, just show me the picture. I'm going to put that bicycle together, and he got 500 pieces sitting over there. Oh, we don't need that. That was just extra stuff. Wear the helmet, wear the pillowcase, everything when you get on the bike. I don't know what we miss. Amen. And we just look at a picture, and we figure out, hey, you got this piece of paper in there. No, it's called. It's called. It's a deep word. It's a deep word. I think you got to fast to get this one. You can't say it out your mouth. You got to fast. Enoch is called instructions.
Yeah, that's right.
It's called instructions. It said if you read part one, part two, part three, and then you flip it over to the other side, the guy in Spanish too. But some knucklehead try to read it in Spanish. All the parts of A, parts of B, and just take your time and do it. Instead of trying to put something together all quick. You got all these parts sitting there. You put it in your little two trailers case. You might need a screwdriver. You might need it now. You don't want that cabinet to fall to pieces. Amen. Follow the instructions. The opposite of instructions is this destruction.
Amen.
So you put a bicycle together, you got parts missing, you look they won't ride it, they need to fill a disclaimer form first. And the devil was gonna happen after you put something together. You got to say, your child will ride his bike, will fill this. Say so you ain't gonna sue because I ain't tell what their head gonna hit that day. They, oh, you don't want to do that.
Amen.
Do it right. Tell them, say, do it right.
Do it right.
Hey man, it takes time. You got to be prosperous, it takes time. You got to develop. Become proficient and skillful with the word of God. You got to know when to sow. You got to know when to give. You got to know when to do them both. When he tell you to do it. You got to know how this is going to lead you to the next stream of income. And someone says, I don't know. That feels a little funny. It feels a little funny because you haven't come in contact with it. Or the last thing you dealt with is an enemy against you. Don't want you to get it. So you got to go beyond that.
Yeah.
Amen. You have to tell you that you got to go beyond that. And people miss out because it's not a job. You say, a job, I'm going out. How far is it? And it's 15 extra miles from the job that you're already going to. This was 20 miles from y'all. So then that's 35 miles. And people do that. They won't calculate distance or cash or time. Well, that business, that's high risk. But okay, you're doing it one time. How many days do you go to work a week? Every day you get in that car in the morning with 1,000 people on the road, that's a risk. Going to work, coming home. But everything else from a computer, oh, that's a high risk. But no, baby, you get in your car, what I'm crazy for, that's a high risk. Because know why? Because in the morning, they putting on mascara. They got that coffee. They putting on pantyhose. Man, I don't know who's in wearing pantyhose anyhow. You know, they texting and all this and checking Facebook and all that. That's high risk. Think about it. See how the world is training us? We think what is not high risk, what is not high risk is high risk, but it is high risk. So the thing that's not high risk is not high risk because you don't, you haven't, the world has trained you to think this way with certain words. Amen. That's a scheme, that's a scam, that's a this and that. And matter of fact, they put those things out there so everyday people would not approach you. That's how you have no middle class. Because you won't come into information. You stay on the other side. So they'll tell you that because they don't want your hands to get on because they know they'll free your life up. And you got people who operate like that. They get paid for it. And every time you read it through Google, whatever, they get paid for it. Every time you watch the video, they get paid for it. Every time you read the blog and all this stuff, they get paid for it because they know that people are attracted to negativity. Let's see where we'll close here. Let's move on. Said, Pastor, are you talking to me? I'm talking to everybody. Okay. Okay, this is where we close. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. We doing all right tonight, y'all?
Yeah.
See, we sweet and sour tonight. We salt and sweet tea. Okay, little herbs, we sweet, little herbs, we're a little salty. You gotta have both, you know what I'm saying? You gotta be like, oh yeah, I'm messing up. You know, okay, you got the truth. Well, oh, that's good. Oh, now you hit me in my stomach. Oh yeah, I gotta get that out of the way. We gotta be like that, because everything can't just be, oh, it's just wonderful. It's wonderful. We gotta deal with the issues in our life. And I know people in those areas. Now he said in verse 7, he said, cast all your care on him, every bill, every concern, every weight, cast on him. Why? Because he cares for you.
Yes.
Now watch this now. Look at this now. Go to the next verse. Yeah, I think he said, be sober, be vigilant. He said, be sober, be vigilant, attend like a soldier, because for this reason, your adversary. Notice something. He didn't say an adversary. He said your personal adversary. You have a personal adversary for against your mind, against your money, and against your family. You have a personal. As a matter of fact, you know it. You just don't know the dude's name or the she name. You just know, hey, just for some reason, be sober. When he said be sober, he means don't be intoxicated with cares. Because cares can make you intoxicated and you make bad decisions when you are intoxicated. Mm-hmm. Be vigilant, stand straight as a soldier, because your personal adversary, the devil, he's like a roaring lion and he's walking about seeking whom he may. He just can't do it. He's seeing who he may devour. In other words, your personal adversary have to get permissions from you carrying cares in order for him to devour.
That's right.
Go ahead. Go to the next verse. He said, whom you resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brother that are in the world. But the key part I want to look at this is that when you carry cares on your life, you are the candidate that he may devour. Because
yeah.
Look at them. They're just drunk as a whistle. And they're not sober. They're not vigilant. He's apathetic. You see that?
Yeah.
See, when you got the bronze eye, you got the, watch your name, you say, bronze eye, got a white mouth. And the boy in the 17, he get it quicker than it over here. Look at it now. So watch it now. When a person, you're always being watched all the time. I tell my daughter, I said, when you're in a car, at nighttime, every 3 seconds, you turn around. You'll be like, oh, where's the black guy? My keys. Now, you got to turn around. Because people are watching your behavior. You follow me?
Yeah.
And people watch you. You got women, ladies, you always got to watch your surroundings. And the devil is always somewhere saying, oh, look at her. Yeah, she intoxicated with a care. But she don't know how she's going to pay that cable bill. She ain't told nobody in the house. She ain't got the money for this and that. Look at how she's walking. Look at it. Why she started arguing when she getting out. Look at it. And watch it. She not even paying attention at nothing because the chaos got her. Devil said, I can devour. I devour. Tear you to pieces. But if you're not intoxicated, you don't cash that care on the Lord. He said, What they do? They ain't the same sister that came out before was out. Because she got in the house, she watched YouTube, she heard this message, she took that care and said, God, this is yours, give me mine. And you came, he said, I'm going to devour her. You come in, oh, with the song you sang Sunday, whatever. God is fighting for us, pushing back to God. In the name of Jesus, everything. He's like, what happened? How you get sold with that quick? Because praise will put you in your right mind.
Right.
And cause you to pay attention and to make your enemies be still.
Hallelujah.
Follow what I'm saying? You're paying attention to everything you need. These are the practical things. You said, well, God gave me what I supposed to happen. I gave him some praise. He said, well, don't let you get it. Come on, guys. Tell your feet. I feel like rolling. Come on, let's get different. Let's give God some thanks. Amen. This is yours. It's yours. It's yours. It's yours. It's yours. It's yours. It's yours. Let me ask you something. When a person go into the military and a sergeant come up there, he said, okay, it's time to do jumping jacks. And you look at home for like doing it. He said, you don't feel like you're going back to your birds. It's okay. He's going to catch up to the law. He said, get over here, you lazy slime worm. You're no good for nothing. Coming from Kentucky Fried Chicken. Come on, stand up here. Give me 50 more. He keep pushing you. He keep pushing you. Why? Because it's a battlefield.
Yeah.
Follow me?
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you, you leave here, you got a battlefield out here. That's why I'm going to be tough with you. You're going to have all kinds of stuff. I'm going to try to bombard you. Try to throw you off your path and distract you and so forth. You said, no, I came from a word preaching church tonight. I'm ready for this field once I get out.
Right.
Let's give God some praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, Father, we thank you tonight for what we receive. Lord God, I acknowledge you that it's your ability, not mine. So, Lord God, therefore, the glory should not be touched. It's all given to you. We're so thankful for what we receive tonight. And Father God, I thank you right now. Peace, blessing, prosperity, and fellowship with the grace, Father God, and the empowerment of your Holy Spirit be so vital in our lives today. Help us, teach us, remind us. I rebuke any enemy or any distractions in their life. I feed the blood of Jesus to them for foul influences and waste of the time. In Jesus' name, angels, in Jesus' name, you are with them. You are with us. I speak this prophetically upon their life that they will have divine encounters of the presence of royal angels among us to help us, to assist us, that we'll be sober and we'll be vigilant in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
And today, if you hear, you never confess Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior. The Bible says today you hear his voice, heart, not your heart. Say, if you confess, if you believe in your heart, confess with your mouth that God sent Jesus and he raised him from the dead for our sins. He sent him to die for. And then he raised him from the dead by justification. He died for our sins and been raised by justification. He said, if you confess that and you believe that, you are saved. It's nothing hard, no matter where you are in life. If you do that, God saved you. And if you need to rededicate your life, you do the same thing. And perhaps you've never been baptized with water. We'll be more than happy to assist you in that area. Or you need baptism in the Spirit with the privilege of speaking in tongues. The utterance that is perfect prayer. We're there to help you. If there's any other prayer request you may have, please comment and we will make sure we get back to you. Or you can email us at myincreasetoday@gmail.com. Love you so very much. We're about to do our offering tonight. And for those who are viewing us, you can give and you can show true desire to. You can go to your app store and type in Give the Five and then type in Increase International Ministries and look for the pastor's picture. Or you can give a Cash App, $5, Increase Today, #5, or you can mail it to P.O. Box 2295, Chesterfield, Virginia, 23832, or come and bring it. We'd love to see you at 6511 Belmont Road, Chesterfield, Virginia. God bless you. That concludes our service for tonight. Thank you. Make sure you share it with someone that God tells you to in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Receive Pastor Firm as he comes.